Hello and welcome to round 13 of Pro Tour Magic 2015. We've got a great match that we're going to be starting with on camera here for you. On the left of our screen, we're going to have Christian Seibold of Germany. He's playing Blue Devotion, looking a little bit surly there because he's down on a five-card hand to start with. The deck I'm really excited about, though, is the one being played by his opponent, Yuki Ichikawa from Japan. He is playing Jund Planeswalker Zach Hill.
Yeah, he's playing a deck, frankly. I mean, we've seen some Jund Planeswalker's builds before, but not like this. Four copies of Nissa World Waker, a big star coming out of Magic 2015. Only, I think, 9 total forests in the deck. But a card good enough to play four copies looks really, by seeing the list, what he ends most games with. So I'm really eager to see how this deck plays out.
Well, Seibold, with a pretty solid start, despite having had to go down to a five-card hand, the turn one Cloudwind Raptor evolving on turn two thanks to a Judge's Familiar, while all we've seen from Ichikawa so far is a Temple and a Scry, drawing for his second turn here. He's got the Lamoire Waste, that means that he's able to cast that Sylvan Caryatid on turn two. So his mana's pretty much sorted from here on out. We can see in his hand there a big Rakdos return potentially at some point, but in the meantime, Chandra and Xenagos not going to be too shabby neither.
Yeah, and that's basically exactly what his deck does. It accelerates its mana with Mystic and Caryatid. Got four Courser of Kruvix because the deck's good, and literally the rest of the deck are removal spells and planeswalkers. Xenagos, Nissa, Chandra, Vraska, the removals, Mizzium Mortars, Dreadbore, Charm, Abrupt Decay, Putrefy, Ultimate Price, and one Rakdos Return. So really linear plan for the deck. Just accelerate out Planeswalkers, gain advantage, and kill everything that walks.
I mean, Chira Pandramaster, also pretty good at killing everything that flies. They're able to offer Judges Familiar with the plus one ability. Ticking up, obviously not too bad when you're facing down creatures that can fly through comparatively easily anyway, and actually killing something off, kind of a bonus.
I mean, and you saw the look on Seibold's face there. Chandra, a great card advantage engine, but a lot of time you're taking up just to deal damage, and you can kill a creature with that. It is a blowout.
So Seibold respecting the Planeswalker enough there to attack it rather than doing anything else. There's a good chance that Yuki will be able to protect his Chandra a little bit better in future turns, because that Sylvan Caryatid will potentially be able to block. And here we can see in Seibold's hand that one of the reasons for his concern, he's got plenty of interesting spells there, but most of them he can't really play, because with an Island and a Mutavault, all of those double and triple blue costs just not working for him.
Yeah, I mean, Seibold, you know, mulligan down to five. Ichikawa's deck is on top of things. He's got a Xenagos over there to blend with Chandra, can start making Satyr tokens. Chandra can start taking up. I mean, not able to really muster much of an offense on Seibold's side, and this is really where those colorless lands have a very meaningful drawback.
I mean, if I'm Christian Seibold here, I'm going to try and make this game last as long as I can, not necessarily because I think I have a great shot at winning it, but just because something kind of unusual is going on the other side of the board, and I want to work out as much as I can about what I might be facing in games two and potentially three.
Now, did Chandra not tick up that turn? Was it? Did it activate in order to get either one of those lands or Xenagos? I noticed it's...
I think it was the zero ability there.
Okay.
I mean, there wasn't anything that Chandra could kill off, and I think the one point of damage, not necessarily quite as much of concern.
So he's able to evolve the Cloudfin Raptor and get rid of Chandra, but not really a great answer to that Xenagos. An Abrupt K Ultimate Price Rakdos Return, meaning that Xenagos is going to stay on the battlefield for a long time.
Abrupt Decay, a really, really powerful card, and one that we see an awful lot of in other formats, but we haven't seen it do lots of work aside from a few splashes in the Mono Black Devotion decks. Kind of a nice pickup for the Jund deck here, and another good, great reason to play it, really. A lot of potential powerful cards coming down at a cost that Abrupt Decay can deal with them. And there are some control decks in the format, so being able to stop it being countered, just, you know, it cannot be countered as a spell, which means that it's a powerful pickup.
Yeah, and it really comes into play against the specific card Detention Sphere. And the presence of Abrupt Decay really moved a lot of the blue-white decks to adopt a planar cleansing base rather than a Detention Sphere-based one.
And Seibold dejectedly looking at the hand that he's going to have to throw in the graveyard, as Rakdos Return for three is exactly enough to deal 3 points of damage to Tristan Seibold and force all of those lovely spells straight into the graveyard. And kind of the death knell here coming from Yuki Ichikawa's deck. while Ichikawa is the one on lower life total, have to think that that's not something that's going to last for too much longer.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we see Abrupt Decay, Ultimate Price, as we mentioned, able to clear out anything that Zybold is able to draw here. Ultimate Price, relevantly a great answer to Master of Waves. Night Vale Spectre, Frostburn, weird. First, Zybold's going to have to get that third blue mana to deploy Night Vale Spectre. And Hybridization, not exactly what you want to be doing against an offense primarily composed of 2-2 tokens.
Yeah, I mean, now that the Xenagos is on just one loyalty, there might be a temptation to do something other than make tokens, but he could always pull the trigger on the Ultimate Price on that Cloudfin Raptor. It's not necessarily the biggest, scariest threat coming from Cybold, but realistically, with three mana, he just doesn't have big, scary threats, full stop.
Yeah, I really like just making satyrs here, using both your removal spells, or using at least one on the Raptor, dealing with the Tidebiter Mage to get your other 2-2. I mean, if Xenagos just keeps making tokens, I don't even know that the Blue Devotion deck can produce a 2-mana threat every turn, or a threat equivalent to a 2-2 creature every turn.
Ichikawa here, having a little bit of a think. One of the more creative deck builders out there. I mean, there was certainly a time where Japan was the hotbed of creativity. We still see the occasional flurry of tweets of various decks coming from none other than Tomohiro Saito. This deck, though, not one that I really had on my radar at all. It'll be interesting to, if we get a chance to speak to Christian Cyborg later, to find out whether or not it's something that he was testing against at all.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the Jund Planeswalkers decks we've seen feature cards like Domri Raid, featured the new Garrick out of Magic 2015. But Nissa, especially four copies of Nissa, not really the standard technology. A lot of the players who are on this deck were talking to me and saying, you know, what they're trying to do is get around Lifebane Zombie. They don't want to get a Polukranos hit with a Lifebane. They don't want to get even a Reaper of the Wilds hit with a Lifebane. They just want Planeswalkers. So that's kind of how a lot of players arrived at this deck.
I mean, in total, looking at the list there for Ichikawa, he's only got 12 straightforward creatures, Elvish Mystic, 4 Sylvan Caryatid, 4 Courser of Crufix. Obviously, he'd rather have them in play than not, but if all he ever drew was lands and Planeswalkers and removal, he'd be totally happy with that.
And that's exactly what we're seeing now. He drew one of those Nissa World Wakers. So Nissa at 4 loyalty, and Xenagos now has made, I think, 4 satyrs. I mean, just not any good way to come back for that from blue. Blue Devotion, not a deck besides Master of Waves, known for its ability to come back in the first place.
Yeah, it looks like Christian Cybold kind of felt the same there. I mean, I think that as soon as he mulliganed to 5, he knew that he was going to be drawing fairly slim against any matchup whatsoever. But he's got some useful information from that first game in order that he can potentially do something special in games 2 and potentially 3. But we'll be having a look at one of the other tables fairly shortly, right after we go to these messages.
Ultra Pro is the place to go for all your Magic accessories. With card sleeves, deck boxes, play mats, and portfolios showing off the best Magic art, Ultra Pro is the standard in safe storage. Visit ultrapro.com for more information. Standard is the name of the game at Magic 2015 Game Day. Put what you've learned from watching the Pro Tour into action on August 9th and 10th at your local game store. Visit wizards.com/magicgameday for more information.
Well, as Christian Cybold and Yuji Ichikawa look to their sideboards to figure out what to do for their later games, we're going to have a little live look-in on one of our other matches. Over on the back table there, we see on the left of our screen, that's John Finkel. He's joined by Elspeth and indeed a rolling cavalcade of soldier tokens there who are presenting a clear and present danger to none other than Ivan Flock on the right of our screen, who's playing blue-white control. You do not want to see a Quicken from the blue-white control decks, though. If all it's doing is drawing a card, I would be quite surprised. Normally what comes after this is, there it is, that's a supreme verdict. See your tokens, you're not going to be doing a whole lot. Though, I guess, oh look, there's a few more straight afterwards from Elspeth. That the power of Elspeth, Sun's Champion.
You don't see very many active Planeswalkers with 10 loyalty very frequently, but it looks like Flock had cast a Sphinx's Revelation pretty recently. What did you say for? Oh, is that, that
that's
7?
7 loyalty,
oh, okay.
Yeah. We don't have 6-sided dice going up to 9 round here. It just doesn't come up very often.
I think I got punked pretty hard on that.
But there we have a Blood Baron of Viscopa joining the soldier tokens for John Finkel. It not necessarily as powerful in this matchup as it is against the black control decks, but there's still a few cards that can't be particularly well deployed against a Blood Baron, the likes of your Banishing Lights and so on. Interestingly, it looks like Ivan Flock has one of his win conditions in play here in the artifact that he has in play there, because
Elixir of Immortality.
Yeah, with the Elixir of Immortality, he is able to shuffle in the powerful cards from his graveyard, and ultimately, his is a deck that's kind of just looking to say, I'm going to cast Sphinx's Revelation until you don't want to play Magic the Gathering anymore.
Yeah, it's interesting to think about that card, because there's a long history of cards like Gaia's Blessing, like Rishadan Pawn Shop, I believe, going way back.
Soldevi Digger?
Soldevi Digger, exactly, where, you know, basically a control deck just draws so many cards that what it wants to do is just shuffle it, get its graveyard back into its library so that the deck just gets denser and denser with threats, more and more and more relevant cards, and that's exactly what Elixir does for this deck. It allows it, you know, even though it runs only four Supreme Verdicts, to essentially have an endless number of Verdicts, an endless number of Sphinx's Revelations, and even if it only has a single threat, like Aetherling, if that threat gets Thoughtseized, you just get it right back. So Elixir does a lot of work in decks like this.
Yeah, I mean, Ivan Flock, he knows that gradually over the course of the game, he's going to draw a ton of lands. They're going to go into play. Everything else, though, could get shuffled in. But by the looks of it, the shuffling here is going to be a little bit more decisive. I'm guessing that the amount of threats that John Finkel was able to deploy to the board there, more than Ivan Flock was able to deal with. So they're shuffling up. And actually, by the looks of things, we've got some simultaneous shuffling going on in just about all of the tables at the same time. We might be able to get a little bit of a look in, though, over on the King of the Hill match, though. Matt Sperling is playing up against Ben Friedman. Both of these players on 10 and 2. That the second best record in the tournament at the moment, our current leader being William Jensen. But the man in the hat, Ben Friedman, that hat, not just a weird combination cowboy Australian hat. No, no, that's also the crown of the current King of the Hill. And the current King of the Hill has just cast a Sin Collector and is looking at an awful lot of very aggressive cards from Matt Sperling. Eidolon of
Revel
there, a Skullcrack hitting the graveyard, a Shock and a Chandra's Phoenix. Pretty aggressive deck, it would be safe to say, there from Matt Sperling.
Well, it's interesting. We've seen a lot of flavors of red. We've seen the Rabble red deck. We've seen a red deck, so the Raw-style red deck, 17, 18 lands, a Crowan Crusaders. This deck, almost all burn spells. Usually it features just Ash, Zealot, Chandra's Phoenix, and a fistful of burn, which is why you bring in a card like Sin Collector against it. But reasonably good draw right now, and a card like Chandra's Phoenix actually tends to give these base black decks fits. They just have to keep killing it over and over and over again.
Now, we do know from watching Ben play last round that he potentially has access to a Whip of Erebos, and that's something that could be a big problem for Matt Sperling. While the red deck's really very, very efficient at dealing 20 points of damage, they can sometimes struggle to deal, you know, 25, 30 damage, some order of magnitude greater than 20. And another Sin Collector there, swinging and missing, but the one swinging straight for Sperling's face, doing just fine.
Yeah. Yeah, is that a second Sin Collector there now? Spelling meaningful problems now for Sperling. I mean, Sin Collector, basically one of the best things you can do, because, you know, they're racing the Chandra's Phoenix very successfully.
But it sounds like our players over on our main table are just about ready to get started. And frankly, I do not want to miss a moment of this Planeswalkers deck. I cannot wait to see a little bit more of the Jund deck. Not your classic Jund, lots and lots of different Planeswalkers. And actually with a mix of Xenagos, Nissa, Chandra, and a single Vraska the Unseen, it's, you know, using some of the Planeswalkers that we haven't actually seen in play quite so much as some of the mainstays of other constructed formats.
This looks like an unbelievable draw for Ichikawa, though. He's got two mana accelerants. He's got two Miscutter Hydras, which essentially have protection from Zybold's deck. And Zybold, again, not really able to... Oh, okay, he's got his third island for the Nightfall Spectre. He didn't have that to begin with, so those Thassa is going to turn on fast. And Master of Waves, one of the few cards capable of racing these Hydras. But, I mean, we're going to see a turn three Hydra for four that's attacking that Zybold can't block and can't kill. So Ichikawa doing exactly what he wants to do right now.
Yeah, and the accelerants that he had on turns one and two, absolutely critical for just how good this Hydra is. The Hydra on its own very, very powerful against the Blue Devotion deck. But it needs to come out not just on time, but a bit ahead of time. And that's exactly what Ichikawa has been able to achieve here. A very, very powerful sideboard card for Ichikawa, and one that I think we're going to see doing an awful lot of work.
Now that's a big hit off that Nightveil Spectre for Seibold, getting a Mutavault able to deploy Master of Waves, a lot of power on its own. And crucially, Mutavault able to block Mistcutter Hydra. Even a chump block matters a lot if he's able to crack in for 10, 12 points of damage with that Master of Waves Inspector. So Mutavault, very, very important to the tenor of this game.
We have a race on our hands, and it's one that I wouldn't really want to call, because the thing is that Ichikawa can play another Hydra this turn, right?
Yeah, he can attack Seibold down to just 7, but not really any sort of answer to that Master of Waves. He might be seeing a little more defense from Ichikawa. I mean, I think what you do is just cast a 5-5 Hydra here and start attacking, but that does not give you a lot of time.
I mean, Ichikawa, I think, can afford to be a little bit defensive here, because he does have a lot of great draws. He's got a Golgari Charm. He's got an Abrupt Decay. He's got a Putrefy. He's got Ultimate Price. All of these successfully deal with Master of Waves. And once you've dealt with Master of Waves, there's not really a huge amount going on from Christian Seibold's side of things.
Yeah,
he's got Doom Blades out the sideboard. There's all sorts of things that he can do to potentially square up this board. It's just a matter of surviving long enough to do so.
Right. Even Mizzium Mortars, if he has it, he can come pretty... Yeah, I think he can overload right now, so it may not kill Master straight up, but it certainly deals with the tokens and the Spectres, so...
Wow, this is an interesting attack here from Yuki Ichikawa. He didn't tap his Elvish Mystic. He's decided to keep that back just so that he can keep Christian Seibold honest in terms of attacking with the Master of Waves. But he is saying, you know what, I don't want to give you too much time. I'm going to knock you down to 8. I've got 8 power of unblockable, or, well, nearly unblockable Hydras. Let's race.
I'm really impressed by that play, because what has to happen, Seibold, the only way to interact at all with the Hydra is to block with Mutavault. So by keeping the Elvish Mystic back, he essentially trades one potential damage by making a 5-5 Hydra for 2 potential damage from the Master of Waves not attacking, and now he has the option of blocking one of those tokens if he wants to. So essentially he traded 1 mana for, or 1 damage for 4 damage if he wants to block, which is exactly what he does. Not the most intuitive play, but I think it's going to give him a lot more time here.
Oh, another great pickup there in terms of what's come off the top of Ichikawa's deck for Christian Seibold with Nightveil Spectre, a second Mutavault. Effectively, each of these Mutavaults is just buying a mountain of time, but with 2 of them at the same time, in principle, he could block and trade with one of those Hydras. As it is, though, I'm pretty sure he's going to use them as functional time warps or fogs, perhaps, on the attacks that are coming across from the 4-4 Hydras on each Kawa's side of the board.
And I would completely agree with you. I'll point out that Ichikawa only has 2 Mutavaults in his entire deck. So,
oh, my. What's the reverse of a top deck? Because that's exactly what's happened twice in a row.
When you top deck off your opponent's deck, yeah, I mean, that is some truly crazy results. Probably the best card in Ichikawa's entire deck to hit off Nightveil Spectre, because, you know, even if you were able to hit some of those green, red, or black threats that could theoretically deal with Hydra, you'd have to have the land to cast them first. Mutavault is the land and the interaction all rolled into one, so now Ichikawa might have to make some difficult decisions.
How sickening would it be to get home after your big tournament? You had a great weekend, but be like, if I just played basic lands instead of those Mutavaults, then I'd have made the top 8 of the Pro Tour.
I can't imagine.
So Ichikawa here, left with a little bit of thinking to do. We can see him checking out what's going on the board before he carefully makes his way into the red zone with those Hydras. And here comes the first Mutavault. Is the second one blocking as well? Or is there an extra trick here coming from Christian Seibold?
I'm looking at Seibold's hand. He's got Thassa, God of the Sea, so if he gives up both Mutavaults, he won't be able to play Thassa and make a creature unblockable. I think he's going to want to do that if Ichikawa is able to deploy a lot of blockers to the battlefield. He's got Scavenging Ooze and Sylvan Caryatid in his hand, but Seibold has more attackers than Ichikawa has blockers anyway, so it might represent an extra Mutavault attack. If he's got lethal, the unblockability only matters if there's a particular threat he wants to force through. It does allow him to attack with Master of Waves, which he was unable to do last time due to the Llanowar Elf that was held back.
Yeah, it's interesting. Christian Seibold has a lot of experience playing the kind of aggressive role. I mean, we saw him make top 8 at Pro Tour Born of the Gods playing Affinity. That's certainly one of the more intricate decks when it comes to navigating the attack step. And so he's very carefully planned out what he's going to do here. He is going to be facing down that Scavenging Ooze and the Sylvan Caryatid. Blockers all, but possibly not enough blockers to be able to square up this second game.
Yeah, so Seibold has, what, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, potentially 6 attackers, 3 blockers. That would take Ichikawa to 2. So Seibold has to figure out how to deal 2 more damage here. If he drew another Master of Waves, that make the elementals bigger, but that just allows Ichikawa to block the elementals.
So I can't help but think that what's going through Christian Seibold's head is, maybe I can attack with Night Vale Spectre and find another Mutavolt. Now, what he doesn't know is that that's literally not possible. he cannot possibly know how lucky he's already been right. In terms of his Night Vale Spectre hits. But it would certainly be a tempting thought for me when he's actually in kind of a rough spot here, because I'm not convinced that he's going to be able to force through the damage he needs on this exact turn.
Yeah, I mean, his Mutavolt is a 3-3, but, I mean, Ichikawa's just going to block the biggest creature, so it doesn't really matter. I'm trying to see if there's anything he could hit off the, yeah, off the Night Vale. You're absolutely right. Mutavolt would be the best possible, but, yeah, there just isn't another one. So Seibold, within 1 or 2 points of damage, you know, Thassa could make an elemental unblockable if he's, you know, it can make Mutavolt unblockable, which is 3 damage. So that's, let's see, if you play Thassa, you can't activate the Mutavolt, though. So just constrained very close on mana and damage. It just looks like it's not quite enough.
I'd actually forgotten that Mutavolt was a 3-3. Surely on the previous turn, it would have made sense to double block a Hydra because he would have been able to only lose 1 Mutavolt to that block.
That's a really excellent point. Yeah, he could have double blocked a Hydra and actually killed it with both Mutavolts. That was a big, big moment for Seibold.
I mean, I'm sure that, I mean, Seibold does have Mutavolts in his deck. It's an interaction that will have come up from time to time for him, but potentially, I mean, it may be something that, you know, viewers watching back on the tape later can double check whether or not the mana was available. I think there was extra mana available on that turn, though.
I also think there was, yeah. I mean, maybe he was playing around a removal spell from Ichikawa that would have totally blown him out and made him face lethal next turn, but at 4 he faces lethal anyway. That could have been a big decision.
So here comes the Night Vale Spectre. He's rolling a dice. Let's see what we got.
6.
Wow.
Mizzium Mortars. I mean, he's certainly happy to have denied Ichikawa that draw, because I think that that would have been enough that Ichikawa could certainly win this next turn. He's got the extra Mutavolt, so he still has the potential to get that double block on. But now he's facing 2 lethal attackers, and he only has 2 creatures that can potentially block them.
That second Mutavolt is very important, though, because by holding both of those Miscutters back, with Ichikawa at 6 instead of 8, that sheds the math in his favor, unless that Scavenging Ooze is able to become active, which will pad Ichikawa's life total. Yeah, I think Ichikawa has enough green mana and is able to force enough creatures to die that he can stay out of range.
Well, I mean, many of the creatures that are going to be dying aren't going to be sitting in the graveyard, right?
Oh, that's right, because the tokens, yeah, they go away. Mutavolt, if it dies, it's a land. Yeah, that's a really good point. There's a lot of creatures that can die that aren't going to be creatures in the graveyard.
An awful lot of interactions here that Ichikawa needs to consider. Ultimately, sort of, it's almost more important to make sure that you make these plays correctly when you're winning than, I mean, at this point when Christian Seibold is losing, there's quite possibly no line that's going to keep him alive. So sort of, he can afford to sort of potentially be a little fast and lose. Ichikawa's going to potentially feel a little bit silly if he manages to throw away what would be a winning position here.
We can sit and count the board. If Ichikawa's at 7, we see a scry just to get some more information. So, again, Seibold has 6, potentially as many as 8 attackers. Still not quite enough if Ichikawa blocks everything with 3 power. So I think for Ichikawa, you just got to get those Hydras in there.
I mean, Seibold's creatures all basically sat in the red zone on our feature match area anyway. They're ready to rumble one way or another. We've just heard that Ben Friedman has managed to take his match against Matt Spurling 2-1. So he's still king of the hill and in great shape now to potentially make top eight. In the meantime, Yuki Ichikawa attacking with both his Hydras. All of those Mutavolts went to the bin for Christian Seibold. He now just needs to figure out whether or not there's a way for him to squeeze through 7 points of damage.
Wow. That
could be it.
Yeah, okay, so he's evolving Cloudfin Raptor 1, 2, 3. I think that's going to be enough. Each of those, yeah, that is a lethal attack. That second Master of Waves gives Seibold enough damage to take what was really a god draw almost from Ichikawa. I mean, double Miscutter Hydra, crazy amounts of acceleration. Seibold was able to pull it out.
Yeah, that a really, really interesting game, and one that I think that it's going to be one that Ichikawa might value the opportunity to look back on later, because there are a lot of potential lines that both players could have taken there, and was there a way for him to have won that one? Possibly. In the meantime, though, we get to have another live look in on our match at the back table there on the left of our screen. That the 14-time Pro Tour top 8er John Finkel up against Ivan Floch, former Team World champion. Floch on blue-white control, and it looks like he's already got one Sphinx's Revelation that might have done some work. But right now, he's going to be more concerned with there's a 7-7 Desecration Demon and a Lifebane Zombie in play for John Finkel.
Okay.
Each of them potentially a big threat. Quicken, is there the Supreme Verdict to go with it?
No, that's an Azorius Charm. Not quite the same thing, although it can deal with the demon. Oh, there's a main phase Quicken.
When you see a main phase Quicken, you know you're in good shape.
And a Planar Cleansing is sort of like a Supreme Verdict. Cost a little bit more, but going to accomplish the same thing.
So Planar Cleansing are really sort of an interesting defining card for types of control decks, because many of them use the likes of Detention Sphere and so on. But with Planar Cleansing, you can come over the top of that plan. You can deal with Planeswalkers, but equally you can't really play that plan yourself.
Now we see Deicide, the only card remaining in Flock's hand. He really needs to rip a Sphinx's Revelation here. And that is exactly what happens. So Seibold facing down 6 damage and a big threat. Flock, sorry. But yeah, Sphinx's Revelation right back in this game.
Sphinx's Revelation, the entire time it's been in Standard, has been one of the defining cards that we've seen control players playing. The potential here to say, well, it might look like I'm dead, but actually, no, I'm going to be drawing 7 cards and gaining 7 life, and I'm not just alive, but have a billion more options. And by a billion, I mean 7. Flock counts them out. He's not going to be too worried about the fact that Finkel here gaining a little bit of life off the attack, because that's not really the way that the blue-white decks go about things. It's not about sort of saying, I'm going to nickel and dime you until you go from sort of one life to zero. It's about developing overall board control and then at some point kind of ending the game.
Yeah. John, yeah, hand on his head. I mean, that's the worst possible thing that could have happened to him. He's still got 2 creatures on the battlefield. I'm looking at Flock's hand. He drew a lot of lands there, but he's got a divination. He can draw to some more gasoline. Tenor definitely shifted with that revelation.
Flocky, there's a good chance he's going to end up having to discard something at the end of this turn. So many cards in hand right now.
Is that a verdict on the left side of his hand there? Yeah, I think it is.
Bingo bongo. Creatures in the bin. Ivan Flock pretty happy with the way this board looks. But on top of all that, he does have a way of making it better. That there, Jace able to mean that it's up to 5 loyalty. Any attackers coming from John Finkel will have 1 less power, but more, it's about threatening doing bigger and better things on subsequent turns.
And with enough cards in his hand, I mean, I could see him thinking about just ultimating the Jace.
John Finkel there holding Blood Baron above the table. He's not entirely sure whether or not it's going to resolve, and there is a dissolve coming from Ivan Flock to say, not only was that not going to resolve, but I'm going to see if I can improve my draws with a little bit of scry.
Yeah, and I mean, the game went from Finkel firmly in command to now this being Flock's game to lose. Wow, another Supreme Verdict, preventing any shenanigans, just ticking up that Jace. Yeah, I think he wants to end this game quickly because he knows he's going to have to play 3 games.
Yeah, time very much a factor. I mean, there's 26 minutes at the moment, which sounds like a lot, and it kind of is, but in point of fact, neither of these decks necessarily will end games super lightning fast, and nobody really wants a draw that they haven't planned for, sort of thing.
Yeah, I mean, yes, that is exactly right. You do not want an unintentional draw, and it is not easy to end games quickly with blue-white, but you're basically ending the game with a Sphinx's Revelation of the order that we're about to see. Another just massive play.
Yeah, so
nine cards.
This in response to a Thoughtseize. Basically, what Evatn's saying is, I've got this Sphinx's Revelation that I definitely want to resolve, so I'm going to do that. Yes, you can take the best card from my gargantuan hand, but that's okay because I have a gargantuan hand.
Yeah, that's exactly it.
So all those lands, you can't take any of them, but everything else is fair game, and there's everything else is quite a lot. So that's two Planar Cleansing, two Supreme Verdicts, two Dissolve, two Divination, another Jace, and a Deicide.
Okay, sorry,
there.
I'm at 16.
Yeah, you're at 16, I'm at 12.
John here making a couple little notes as to what he might be facing. He's also got to kind of try and second guess what it is that Ivan is going to have to discard at end of turn above and beyond lands. Because even once you go past the lands, that's what, 4, 8, 10 business spells going on in Ivan Flock's hand here.
Yeah, I mean, John writing this down to see if he can play around it, but doesn't seem like there's a lot you can do at this point.
I mean, when there's two of all of the most powerful spells in Ivan Flock's deck, all in his hand. He takes that Deicide. I mean, that's one unique effect that Ivan Flock did have.
I'm looking at Flock's deck. He has 4 copies of Quicken, 3 copies of Planar Cleansing, 4 Supreme Verdict. So the instant speed board clearing functionality, I think, kind of a focus of his deck. A little bit of a unique blend of blue-white control here. And now we see Jace ticking down to try and give Flock some more cards.
Flock saying, I don't need more lands. I'm going to be discarding lands at the end of this turn anyway. I'll take an extra Supreme Verdict. Here's a Planar Cleansing.
Yeah, basically ticking Jace down just to be able to blow up that connections.
Yeah, it's amazing how once you've drawn, 11 cards, you can just say, I don't mind the card disadvantage of killing one of my own Planeswalkers.
Right.
This is one of those weird moments where, even though on the board and even looking at life totals, it would be hard to call who's actually winning. In practical terms, I think it's kind of all about Ivan Flock. And with that, we are going to move back to our main table, our match between Christian Seibold and Yuji Ichikawa. They're just going to be kicking off the deciding game now between Mono Blue on the left of our screen and Jund Planeswalkers on the right.
Is this, again, another 5-card hand from Seibold?
I think he took one mulligan, okay. And he's got a Cloudfin Raptor on turn one, so not the worst position to be in. I mean, if you had to pick something to play on the first turn, that would be it for the blue deck anyway. Scavenging Ooze from Ichikawa, probably not as important as a regular Accelerant, especially given that it looks like there's a Miscutter Hydra in Ichikawa's hand.
Yeah, you really want an Accelerant there. And as we saw, I mean, Hydra doesn't always do it, but those were just some huge Mutavault hits earlier. And I think with a more normal game, that Hydra, even on 3, is going to represent a giant threat.
I'm guessing that we're going to see a Courser of Trufix this turn. A relatively solid card anyway in terms of just stalling the ground, potentially attacking for a bit. But the main thing is getting extra cards off the top of the deck there. And so now it looks like Ichikawa is likely to have 2 copies of Misfail Hydra again, or Miscutter Hydra, sorry. And their Thassa, God of the Sea for Christian Seibold, which at the moment, just an enchantment, not a creature.
So Ichikawa, a lot of options here. He could play Blood Crypt, Hydra for 3. He could play the Temple off the top of his deck, which only allows a Hydra for 2. But he could use the opportunity to cast Mortars or Price on the Raptor. I like gaining card advantage by playing the Temple off the top of your deck and then just using some removal spells and attacking for smaller points. I mean, he's able to attack for 5 by killing the Raptor and eating it with Ooze, so not too weak.
And the thing is that because Seibold has 2 copies of Mutavault in play, going for the really aggressive minimal Hydra plan just doesn't seem that exciting to me at all. I'd much rather go, let's have a Hydra that's big enough that it can rumble with those mutavaults, eventually kill people off, but in the meantime, I'm going to make sure that Thassa does not get active.
Yeah, that's a really solid plan. Getting the Raptor off the table means that it's not going to get big due to a Master of Waves. It's fewer devotion for both Thassa and Waves. It just puts Zybold even more on the defensive, not going to be able to steal a game out from nowhere, and Ichikawa can just cast a Hydra next turn.
Yeah, I mean, Ichikawa, his life total is going up rather than down. He's got creatures on the board. He's in a great position to kind of build inevitability. He just needs to close the door on Seibold's best draws. And I think that killing creatures off where he can is going to do that. Seibold's draw, kind of a weird one, because by and large, the mono blue deck doesn't really want to draw tons of mutavaults early on, because a lot of its threats, you know, in line with its devotion theme, do require multiple blue mana. But at the same time, they are good against Miscutter Hydra. So an interesting position for Christian Seibold to be in. Looks like he's not entirely comfortable with the situation, though I'm sure that the double blue that allows him to cast Tidebinder Mage is going to help with that.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, though, that is a big downside of having to play a Mutavault early. It means that your third land can't cast your Night Vale Spectre. When you have two Mutavaults, it means your fourth land can't cast Night Vale. And when you have Thassa, God of the Sea, on the battlefield, about all you want to do is get a Night Vale Spectre on the board.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be interesting to see what happens to the blue devotion decks as and when Return to Ravnica rotates out of standard when Khans of Tarkir comes into play. Because one of the things that's made the blue devotion deck so powerful is the fact that with just one card, you can get three extra devotion from that Night Vale Spectre. Whether the likes of Master and Waves and co. will be able to stand up to the other things going on in standard without the Night Vale Spectre is something we're going to have to find out about, I guess.
Yeah, you also lose out on some of those hybrid cards that fuel that in addition to the Night Vale Spectre. I mean, Frostburn Weird is the big loss. I think your mana base is a big loss, but you're right, though, that the core of the deck in terms of Thassa, God of the Sea, and Master of Waves are in the Theros set, so if there's really anything to replace them, we could see this deck remaining largely intact.
And five mana. Looks like 4-4 is sort of the magic number in terms of making Mistcutter Hydra do its thing. Ichikawa doesn't want to sit back for too long with it. He does need to sort of continue to present a threat. And that there, 6 damage coming in on Christian Seibold means that he's not got too much longer that he can expect to be able to sit on his laurels and build his board, because Ichikawa's coming for him.
Yeah, and Seibold at 7 life means that those Hydras, again, basically just demand to be chump blocked every turn or they're going to be lethal, so...
I mean, Seibold doesn't know that there's another Miscutter Hydra coming. He saw one on the top of Ichikawa's deck, so there was really no downside to Ichikawa playing that one out, making it clear to Seibold that that part of the game had happened. The second one will effectively be a much bigger surprise and potentially a lethal one. Tapping out here. This may be something that Christian Seibold comes to regret, because he now has nothing that's able to block a Miscutter Hydra. And look how quickly Yuki Ichikawa is playing. Boom.
Yeah.
There's a Hydra. A big thumbs up from Seibold, but he's not too happy about it. It comes very shortly followed by a handshake. Congratulations, Yuki Ichikawa. He wins that game. Two games to one. So we're going to be jumping across to see a little bit more of Hall of Famer John Finkel up against Ivan Flok from the Slovak Republic. When we last left, it looked like Flok was pretty firmly in command. It looks like he took that one. So we're on to our third game here. Pack Rat has happened. And a duress here means that John Finkel is going to be able to get a little look at what's going on. Planar Cleansing, Jace, Elixir of Immortality. A few interesting things to pick out here. I'd be kind of interested about taking the Elixir here, because actually, often these decks only have one copy, and once you've dealt with it, that cuts off one entire axis that the control decks can take.
Yeah, I mean, the alternative to that is one Revelation for any sizable amount's probably going to bury you anyway. I like taking Jace here and giving them no velocity. That means that Flok would just have to rely upon his draw step to get anything alive. That Planar Cleansing not coming out until turn 6, not doing anything about the Pack Rat. Elixir, really bad until you have a loaded graveyard, but I do see your point, Tim, about being able to take away that inevitability. I mean, the Elixir is in the deck for a reason. It's because it gives it unstoppable late game power while John taking Cleansing.
The road less traveled, at least by us. But I mean, I guess that he's saying, well, none of the other things actually stop a Pack Rat. Packrat can quite happily continue to do its thing against everything else, and that's my plan.
We actually see John missing his second land drop, so I think he knows that he is going to be pretty heavily on the Packrat plan, and he can, you know, make sure that Jace, if it hits a Supreme Verdict, is going to have to take it, not really gain that much active card advantage, and you know, in doing the math, he realizes that Packrat's not going to kill Yvonne before he gets to Planar Cleansing mana.
And also, I guess, the way that things stand, Jace is going to be pressured in both directions. Normally when you cast Jace, you kind of want to be able to say, I'm going to tick up a bit, tick down a bit, do my thing. At the moment, Flock's not really going to have the chance to do that. He's going to have to either say, I desperately need to dig for a Supreme Verdict, or I need to kind of try and stem the bleeding where I can by ticking up, but with a few pack rats on the board, at some point that just doesn't become a reasonable plan.
Now we saw Flock draw Sphinx's Revelation, so he's able to get himself some more cards, but you really don't want to be casting Sphinx's Revelation for one, two, or really even three. So, yeah, your point's excellent, Tim. You can play Jace and activate it, but that just means Jace is going to die. And if he ticks it up, it's going to die too. So, I mean, basically he's able to cash in a Jace for a Supreme Verdict, but that doesn't really get him anywhere.
Yeah, so John's still going to be able to get in and attack here, kill off Jace, do a little bit more damage to Flock. Yes, he's going to lose his creatures to a Supreme Verdict, but he can play around that. He knows it's going to be coming. He can plan around it and make the best play for him for this exact turn with that in mind. Giving extra information to John Finkel, not the sort of thing that you want to do too much if you can help it.
Still, Flock has a charm now, which allows him to draw even more cards. He's going to be able to cast Supreme Verdict, play that Hallowed Fountain. He's got an island, so that means he's going to be able to fire off a big Sphinx's Revelation, unless John's able to draw another discard spell. Hero's Downfall, not particularly relevant right now. Neither is the Lifebane Zombie. He just needs to get enough lands to be able to cast that Elspeth and hope that Elspeth can go the distance before Flock's able to fire off a big Revelation.
Thinking about John Finkel getting information, this another thing, of course, that his zombie does there, revealing, lo and behold, Lifebane Zombie not able to take either a green or a white creature, but you know what, it doesn't matter because the info is still useful, as is the 3-1 body.
That is not a sixth land, that's a Desecration Demon. Still, Finkel can cast that demon. We've seen him go through a Planar Cleansing and a Supreme Verdict. Flock shuffled them back into his deck, but that's still not that many answers to the demon. And Flock, I think, forced to Revelation for three. Definitely good for him, but not as powerful as it could be.
I mean, what John's doing here is putting pressure on every decision that Ivan Flock has to make. He's saying, I know that if I give you enough time, you are going to win this match. Yours is the deck that has the ability to make these insane late-game plays that are very difficult to match. I'm going to force you into trying to make those late-game plays in the early to mid-game, really. And Sphinx's Revelation for three, you know, it's a very powerful card, but it's no Sphinx's Revelation for seven, is it?
No, exactly. Oh, but Flock just has another Revelation in his hand and a Dissolve. That means that if Finkel gets his sixth land for Elspeth, it's just going to get countered. Oh, okay, Revelation not currently in his hand, but Dissolve still very relevant. So the demon on top of Finkel's deck and a Jace for even assures that he's going to be able to continue gaining card advantage.
The blue-white deck with Sphinx's Revelation, super tough on our spotters keeping track of cards in hand. And a lot of cards, a lot of life changes. Not the easiest ones. We'll try and keep up with Flock's hand where we can, but it may be that every now and again there's one or two that are a little bit tricky in there. And both these players playing fairly quickly because time is ticking away on this match. And as we mentioned earlier on, neither player wants to be in a position where there's any kind of potential for a draw.
So John can attack Jace. John can use Hero's Downfall on Jace. Flock, the thing about the blue-white deck is the more cards it's able to look at, the more likely it is it's going to win. And it's been able to muster just enough answers to John's threats that all he has to do is top deck another Sphinx's Revelation to really put the game away.
Desecration Demon resolves, so there is that constant pressure from John Finkel. He's not allowing the game to completely slip away, which is exactly what he needs to do. This Jace does need to go a look in and doesn't really find anything. So we've got two lands and a quicken, and John splits the lands and spells, so he kind of knows that Ivan Flock is digging and says, if you're going to try and dig further with quicken, I'm not going to give you any extra land on top of that. And another land coming off the top there from the quicken. Flock in a difficult position here. He's got plenty of cards in hand, but all of them basically just mana producers. Cycles another quicken.
And it just a grip full of lands for Flock. So Flock has a Mutavault, but 9 damage coming across from John. I mean, that could end the game in just 2 attacks.
Now, do we think, what sort of a read do we think John has on this? I mean, John Finkel, he's been playing on the Pro Tour since there was a junior division on the Pro Tour. Has he successfully been able to determine that in spite of the fact that Ivan Flock has 4 cards in hand, he basically has no action?
And Flock getting hit for 6 damage there. Now, John's attacking Jace means that it's no longer lethal in 2 attacks. But on the other hand, it means that Flock needs a top deck and answer Divination. 2 more chances, and I think he does it. Wow.
2 hits. That a Planar Cleansing and a Sphinx's Revelation. Just enough mana for the Planar Cleansing. Not what John Finkel wanted to see at all.
The 2 best possible cards Flock could have drawn off that Divination. The planar cleansing to empty the board and the revelation to gas right back up, as well as get his life out of threatening territory. And John cannot be excited to see that Sphinx's Revelation.
Yeah, a little shake of the head there as he resolves his zombie there, able to see that Sphinx's Revelation joined by the other part of the combo, extra lands to be able to cast it.
Yeah, with the planes, not even going to have to pay life.
Elixir of Immortality, a bit more of a life buffer, as if Ivan Flock needed it. Also, all of those powerful cards that he's looking at in his graveyard, they'll all get shuffled back in.
So Flock playing the Elixir at the cost of drawing 1 card and gaining 1 life with Revelation, just to make sure it doesn't get hit with a Thoughtseize so that he can use it next turn and just basically have a stacked graveyard, thereby a stacked deck.
Now, Flock, allowing that Underworld Connections to resolve, Flock knows that he's going to be drawing an awful lot more cards than John Finkel's able to, and not willing to do a smaller revelation in the hope of drawing a counter, because he'd much rather just draw a whole ton of cards and do something bigger.
Yeah, your game plan here is to just cast a mammoth revelation, clear the board with another Planar Cleansing. He's got a ton of them in his deck. He can even use his Elixir on his upkeep if he wants to increase the chances of drawing it. So right now, Flock giving up a Mutavault. Actually, wow. Yeah, he's blocking with Mutavault, which is going to be a smaller revelation. But, okay, so his plan is he knows he doesn't have to. A very disciplined play from Flock. He knows he doesn't need to revelation this turn. He already spent a mana on Elixir. He already spent a mana to block. This just ensures that he has an even more threat-dense deck. So he's delaying revelation from a turn in order to ensure that he draws mostly spells. I don't know that I would have had the discipline to make that play.
I know for sure that I wouldn't have done. Almost every conversation you have about, would you have waited on it, would you have gone for it, I pull the trigger. I'm not the best at control decks, it must be said.
So yeah, and Flock just saying, okay, I'll go to 8. I mean, and he doesn't even need to cast Revelation now if he doesn't want to, I suppose. He's not under just tons of pressure.
Okay, now he's under tons of pressure.
Flock didn't even think about Revelation for a smaller amount. I mean, he just said, yep, resolves.
Drawing 8 cards, gaining 8 life, going to a much healthier 14.
I can't begin to tell you how much I appreciate the 4 Quicken 7 Wrath technology. I mean, a card like Obsidat usually gets blue-white control decks fits, but even doesn't even have to care about it. He can, the second that the Obsidat gets back onto the battlefield, he can just clear it out on John's turn.
And the other thing, of course, is that Quicken, just in and of itself, it's a 1-mana cycler.
Right.
A lot of the blue-white control decks are playing Azorius Charm, and much of the time so that they can power through their deck faster.
Right.
Quicken does that at a discount rate and potentially solves a big problem for control.
Yeah, I know we're looking at Flock's deck just saying, I mean, I was doing this to the blue-white control, but this deck list really is a thing of beauty. I mean, it's nothing but board sweeping effects, a few counter spells, and ways of drawing cards. I mean, it's a very pure deck. 4 Azorius Charm, 4 Quicken, 3 Divination, 4 Revelation. Just wants to draw tons of cards every turn. 4 Jace. Or, sorry, 3 Jace. He's got 1 more Jace on the sideboard.
Boom.
That is.
And he can very feasibly run Finkel out of threats here. We're not talking about decking necessarily. We're not talking about literally just exhausting John Finkel of being able to do anything of any great power. Erebos, God of the Dead, though. That's a nice little pickup for John Finkel, because once Sphinx's Revelation just says, draw a whole lot of cards, it's not nearly as powerful.
Yeah, and because Flock is relying upon Planar Cleansing, he actually does not have a way to get Erebos off the battlefield without his one copy of Deicide. He does not have access to Detention Sphere, unlike a lot of the other white-blue decks, and you're right, now Elixir or Sphinx's Revelation can't gain him life, so Erebos a really resonant threat, and Erebos is on. John has 5 Devotion.
Oh, those 2 Underworld connections. I had not seen that. I was just sitting here thinking, how on earth can he get up to the sort of devotion that he needs to do things with it? A 5/7 indestructible creature is going to be potentially, what, a 3-turn clock?
Yeah, now, okay, and he does have the Deicide for Erebos, meaning not only does he get that Erebos, he gets the rest of them. Yeah, John exiles Erebos.
Sure, I just shuffle it. Okay, but you have in hand,
Lamphor. Kind of making sure that even remembers to exile the other Erebos. Or to look at his hand, look at his library if he wants to.
Yeah, I think that he's kind of dispensed with spending too long doing that. Time is very much a factor in this game. Not loads of time left on the map. I think there's just 5 minutes left on the clock at this point. John Finkel, very, very keen to find a way of getting through this. He draws into a hero's downfall, potentially, for that Jace, but he needs to find a way of dealing with Ivan Flock himself, who is on 12 life and potentially quite a bit more if he's able to resolve yet another Sphinx's Revelation.
And Flock dissolving that just needs to look at cards. What he is trying to do right now is dig into Aetherling. He's got, or does he even play Aetherling? I don't think he does.
Yeah, this a very pure control deck in one sense, in that the ways it has of winning the game ever between main deck and sideboard are
2 Mutavault, 1 Elspeth, 1 Jace, 2 Archangel of Thune. So I imagine he has Jace, Memory Adept, and Elspeth in his deck, or those Mutavaults. I mean, he's got a challenge on him now. That Planar Cleansing, getting rid of those Underworld connections, as well as the Sphinx. So even basically, not a lot John can do to win, but Even's goal isn't to not lose. Even's goal is to actively win this match. That Mutavault is going to have to attack 5 times in order to clear this game out. John's going to try very hard to make sure that doesn't happen.
And a seemingly never-ending stream of answers here from Ivan Flock. Kind of inevitable when you've drawn as many cards as he has. He finds a Dissolve and indeed an Azorius Charm to refill his hand. Gets in for another 2. Is this a hero's downfall? There it is. Successfully kills off Mutavault. But you know what's better than Mutavault when it comes to closing out games fast? That would be Elspeth, the Sun's champion.
Yeah, and Elspeth, exactly what Flock was digging for this entire time. Able to get that hero's downfall out of John's hand earlier. So Even's plan, soldiers.
The man plan. So in come 3 soldiers. One of them is probably getting eaten by a Mutavault. The other 2 are going to start nibbling away at John Finkel's life total. Actually, as it turns out, there's an Azorius Charm to make it that the 3 tokens all stay around. Very fast play from here from Ivan Flock. Divination finding him another Azorius Charm. He's then got another Divination, that finding him 2 copies of Planar Cleansing as if he needed them. It's now just a crazy race to get the damage through before the game is called on time. But realistically, we might see an Elspeth Ultimate here. Why not?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great way to end the game fast.
Yeah,
and just keeping, cycling over and over and over again.
I mean, the great thing about using the Azorius Charm on the Mutavault each turn is it means that all that John Finkel is doing is drawing a Mutavault. He's not drawing a Hero's Downfall for Elspeth. He's not drawing anything more powerful. And that enough to mean that he gets the handshake from John Finkel. I mean, Ivan Flock wins that game. He was paired up that round. He was 9-3 going in. And so he will be now at 10-3. 3 losses, pretty much the most losses you can give away if you want to have a reasonable shout at making top 8 at this Pro Tour. That's since the system of having three rounds of draft, five constructed, three draft, five constructed. So a really, really big win there for Van Flock, who is desperately hoping that he can continue to win out, because he's very, very close in the race to be the representative, the national champion, if you will, for the Slovak Republic over at the World Magic Cup. His principal competitor there being Matej Zadelkaj, who Big Z had a big zero wins at this particular event. He did not have a great pro tour whatsoever, having had a pretty spectacular start to the season. So if Ivan Flock can continue with what he's doing right now, he may well be able to snatch that spot at the last possible moment. He's currently gold, and he may even be able to make it all the way up to platinum if he's able to string something together at the very last stages of this Pro Tour.
Yeah, and his ability to string that together and continue that momentum is no small feat. I mean, look at that deck and imagine playing that for 10 constructed rounds. You know, he's essentially got one victory condition in his sideboard. Really impressive performance from Flock.
Who needs win conditions? Sometimes you can win without them, apparently. But we'll find out exactly how Ivan Flock's feeling about that right now, because we're going to head down to the floor where he's ready to speak to our floor reporter, Marshall Sutcliffe.
Hey guys, Marshall Sutcliffe down here in the feature match area. I'm with Ivan Flock, who just won a squeaker against John Finkel. Ivan, talk us through the last few turns there.
Last few turns of third game?
Yeah, the last few sequences.
Well, it seemed I was up, way up in the game, so I just tried to play really quick so I won't get time out, and it's going to end on draw, so I just played quick.
Now, how about the match in general? Do you normally think that matchup is good for you, bad for you?
I don't think it's good for me, especially after Cybert, which is kind of ironic as I won two games after Cybert. But normally, I should have better chances before Cybert and then worse chances after Cybert.
Of course, drawing this particular opponent this late in the tournament also isn't particularly lucky.
Oh, well, yeah, John is obviously a great player and, well, one of the best opponents I can have, if not the best.
Now, what about for you in the tournament? This puts you at X and 3. How does that put you as you start to look for maybe a top 8 here?
I think I need two more wins and then a draw to make top 8. Maybe someone with X4 will make it, but for that we'll need probably good tiebreaks, but well, we'll see about that. But I also need top 16 for platinum. That would be great for two. For that, I think I need one win and one draw, I think.
Okay, so you've got goals and then goals on top of goals. Well, good luck.
Exactly. Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. For Ivan Flock, Marshall Sutcliffe, let's go back to the booth.
Great information there from Ivan Flock. Having another fantastic run. Obviously, we've seen him do well at the World Championships before as part of the Slovak national team, but it's kind of special when you get to do it on your own, and I'm sure that he will be hoping to continue that run deep into this tournament. But we're just about finished on the round now, so we're going to pass back over to the news desk so we can find out what's been going on in the rest of the tournament outside of the feature match area. We'll go and see what's going on there.
Thanks very much to the guys in the booth. The action is coming thick and fast here at Pro Tour Magic 2015. We're going to get straight over to the video wall, because standing there right now, a very special deck tech. The deck is black, white, mid-range. But the man who's about to tell you about it is the man who leads this tournament after 13 rounds at 12-1. He's in the Hall of Fame. It's Hall of Famers all the time over there right now. Randy Buehler and Billy Jansen.